So, what should distros without systemd do? First, consider using GNOME with systemd. This is a real line in a real blog post, and out of context, it's really dumb, it's really funny. In context, there's actually no additional context. That is the entire context. That's actually a real line that was written. This is from a blog post called Introducing Strong Dependencies on systemd. I'll get to the blog post in just a moment, but putting that aside for a second, on Linux, systemd is kind of the standard way we do a lot of very low-level things, from init to timers to background services and a bunch of other things, and there are distros that do offer otherwise. Some of them make it their entire mission to not use systemd. Devuin is a great example. Others just offer it as an option, like in Gentoo. And then you have the whole BSD world where, due to a number of technical and historical reasons, systemd is just never going to be a thing in that place. There may be like a equivalent of systemd that can like work with systemd stuff, but systemd itself is always going to be a Linux thing. So then, on to that post, introducing stronger dependencies on systemd. Doesn't GNOME already depend on systemd? And if you go around to places like the Gentoo wiki, you will find posts like this one, GNOME without systemd. And there's very similar things over in the BSD world. They've made changes to packages, things like that. So the TLDR is, yes, it does depend on systemd, but also no. Basically, they don't have a formal and well-defined policy around it. The rule of thumb is that GNOME doesn't strictly depend on systemd for critical desktop functionality, but individual features may break without it. So GNOME itself is going to work, but if something does rely on systemd and there isn't some sort of fallback available, that thing is going to break. GNOME does strongly depend on LogInD, systemd's session and seat management service, basically a thing that manages user logins. GNOME first introduced support for LogInD in 2011. Then in 2015, ConsoleKit support was removed and LogInD became a requirement. So before this point, both LogInD and ConsoleKit were being used simultaneously. However, LogInD can exist in isolation from systemd, and the modern eLogInD service does just that. And even back in 2015, there were alternatives available. It's gonna load? Yes. LoginKit, systemd shim, and systembsd, a re-implementation of the systemd APIs portable to BSD distributions. While some distributions chose to patch ConsoleKit support back into GNOME, this is linking over to work done in the FreeBSD world. This way, GNOME can run in environments without systemd, including the BSDs. Now, this is the way it's been up until this point. Going forward, there's going to be a heavier reliance and, as it says here, a stronger dependency on systemd. Do keep in mind though that even though this was being done and has basically worked for the past decade, it's not tested by the upstream developers. If you're patching functionality back in, if you're using GNOME in a way that the devs never really intended, it's not something they really support, bugs are not going to be probably dealt with by upstream. It's going to have to be dealt with by your distribution. And if your distribution doesn't have much in the way of development work, you can expect bugs to stick around for quite a while. And it makes sense, right? If you're patching functionality back into GNOME, you're effectively running a fork of GNOME. So what is changing? GNOME is about to gain a few strong dependencies on systemd, and this will make running GNOME harder in environments that don't have systemd available. And I know this is annoying to people on the BSD space, and I know this is annoying to people that don't run systemd. At the end of the day, though, systemd is the way we do things on Linux, and Linux basically is Unix at this point. I don't know the actual market share numbers, but on the desktop especially, I wouldn't be surprised if the entirety of the BSD space is less than 1% of Unix. That would be my guess. If somebody has better numbers, I would love to see it. Also, I shouldn't need to keep saying this, but systemd is not bloated. Can we just stop with this? Can we stop saying, oh, why does my init system have timers and system services and all this other stuff? It doesn't. These are distinct, separate binaries. Systemd is a software suite. It is not a singular application. I really, really wish we could just stop with this. It's so annoying, and people just... It's like so easy to look at your system and show that this is the case. Anyway, here's what's changing. GDM is gaining dependency on systemd's user DB infrastructure, done with this patch right here. Draft use dynamic users for greater sessions. Now, very important question. What is UserDB? Well, let's go over to the documentation and have a look. Systemd user DBD. If there is anything you want to be critical of systemd with, it is the way they name things. This is incomprehensible nonsense. Just stop putting D on the end of everything. It gets real weird when you use D as part of the name. This is a system service that multiplexes user/group lookups to all local services that provide JSON user/group record definitions to the system. In addition, it synthesizes JSON user/group records from classic Unix/glibc NSS user/group records in order to provide full backwards compatibility. Basically, it is a database of the users, and you have information in JSON. That's pretty much it. GNOME and systemd do not support running more than one graphical session under the same user account. So I log in as Brody, I have my one session, and that is all. But GDM supports multi-seat configuration, so having multiple people at the same time, and remote login with RDP, so accessing the system from somewhere else. This means that GDM may try to display multiple login screens at once, and thus multiple graphical sessions at once. At the moment, GDM relies on legacy behavior and straight-up hacks to get this working, but this solution is incompatible with the modern Dbus broker, and so we're looking to clean this up. To that end, GDM now leverages systemd user DB to dynamically allocate user accounts, and then runs each login screen as a unique user. Basically, again, circumventing the problem by instead of having multiple sessions under the same account, you just have multiple accounts. In the future, we plan to further depend on UserDB by dropping the account service daemon, which was designed to be a stopgap measure for the lack of a rich user database. 15 years later, this temporary solution is still in use. Now that systemd's UserDB enables rich user records, we can start work on replacing account service. Now, as for another change, the bigger change. Since GNOME 3.34, GNOME Session uses the systemd user instance to start and manage the various GNOME Session services. When systemd is unavailable, GNOME Session falls back to a built-in service manager. The built-in service manager uses .desktop files to start up the various GNOME Session services and then monitors them for failure, basically implementing a miniature version of that part of systemd. Basically fulfilling the same role, not having every single feature the service manager has, but enough for what GNOME is trying to do here. This code was initially implemented for GNOME 2.24 and is starting to show its age. It has received very minimal attention in the last 17 years since it was first written. If it worked, nobody touched it, because if they touched it, they might have broke something, basically. Really, there's no reason to keep maintaining a bespoke and somewhat primitive service manager when we have systemd at our disposal. The only reason this code hasn't completely bit-rotted is the fact that GDM's aforementioned hacks break systemd, and so we rely on a built-in service manager to launch the login screen. So they couldn't get rid of this solution because of the other hack they were doing, and because they're moving away from that hack to a systemd hack, now this is something that is actually viable. The hacks in GDM are gone, and the login screen session is managed by systemd. This means the built-in service manager will be completely unused and untested. Moreover, we'd like to implement a session save/restore feature, but the built-in service manager interferes with that. For this reason, the code is being removed. So not just not a thing, but like actually getting rid of it. Now, this is not yet merged, so it's entirely possible that doesn't happen, but we will see where it goes. Now, as for the line that I mentioned earlier in the video, so what should distros without systemd do? First, consider using GNOME with systemd. Of course, there is more to the line here, but it doesn't really change the meaning of what is being said. You'd be running in a configuration supported, endorsed, and understood by upstream. Failing that though, you'll need to implement replacements for more systemd components, similarly to what you've done with elogind and eudev. Now, because this is kind of happening just out of nowhere, there is some temporary code paths being enabled. I put an alternative code path into GDM that makes it possible to run GDM without implementation of userDB. When compiled against elogind, instead of trying to allocate dynamic users, GDM will look up and use GDM greeter user for the first login screen it spawns, GDM greeter 2 for the second, GDM greeter n for the nth. GDM will have similar behavior with the GNOME initial setup n users. You can statically allocate as many of these users as necessary, and GDM will work with them for now. This is very important. It's quite likely that this will be necessary for GNOME 49. The for now part is very important. This is a temporary alternative code path. Now, to be fair, one of the other temporary alternative code paths existed for 15 years. So, how long is it actually going to stick around for? Well, nobody has a time machine. Nobody really knows. So it's possible 15 years, or it's possible it lasts until GNOME 50. So this is in place to ensure that places like the BSD world, like GNOME with OpenRC, can actually have a solution in place here if they want to keep going ahead with GNOME. Next, you'll need to deal with the removal of GNOME Session's built-in service manager. If you don't have a service manager running in the user session, you'll need to get one. Just like system services, GNOME Session Services now install systemd unit files, and you have to replace these unit files with your own service manager definitions. Next, you need to replace the session leader process. This is the main GNOME session binary that's launched by GDM to kick off the session startup. The upstream session leader just talks to systemd over dbus to upload its environment variables and then start a unit. So you'll need to replace that with something that communicates with your service manager instead. Finally, you'll probably need to replace GNOME Session CTL, which is a tiny helper binary that's used to coordinate between the session leader, the main dbus service, and systemd. It is also quite likely this will be needed for GNOME 49, which is, again, the next version of GNOME, which comes out in, I actually have a watch here, in about 4 months. Finally, you should implement the necessary infrastructure for the userDB varlink API to function. Once account service is dropped and GNOME starts to depend more on userDB, the alternative code path will be removed from GDM. This will happen in some future GNOME release, 50 or later. By then, you'll need, at the very least, an implementation of systemd userDB's IO systemd multiplexer. If you have NSS, a bridge that exposes NSS-defined users through the userDB API, and a bridge that exposes userDB-defined users through your libc's native user lookup APIs. So a lot of this stuff is going to be present in GNOME 49, which is, again, the next version of GNOME. So for any of those projects out there, like the BSD world, like Gen2 OpenRC, that may want to keep GNOME around without systemd, you have a couple of options. You can hold back the GNOME version, which in the BSD world makes sense. In Gen2 would be a bit weird, unless you had like an alternative package where it's like GNOME without systemd, and it's like an older version of it. I guess that would make sense. Another option is basically to fork it, and I feel like that may end up being the route a lot of things end up going. Or what may happen is you might see the removal of GNOME from some of these contexts as they don't feel like it's necessary to keep it around if there's going to be a lot of this additional work to be done. Again, GNOME is a Linux desktop. GNOME is a systemd desktop. That's what they want to support. And you can say whether or not that's a good thing or not. That's totally fine. But that is the choice they have made, and that is something that distributors outside of that space are going to have to work out how and if they want to deal with. But what do you think? Are you a GNOME user? Do you use GNOME in an environment that doesn't have systemd? And if you do that, why GNOME? Like, what is it about GNOME that makes you want to keep using it? And do you hope that whatever environment you have, whether that be Devwin or one of the BSDs, keeps it around going forward? I'd love to know. So, if you like the video, go like the video. If you really like the video and you want to become one of these amazing people over here. Check out the Patreons, Grabs, and LiberaPay linked in the description down below. That's going to be it for me, and... maybe think twice. I don't know. What is this?